Hello everyone, we are here for you at the Daughter 4. And before we start this August hour in July, I would like to first thank all of you for the absolutely wonderful and stunning response to our brand new initiative. And here was a little 2 minute highlights from the first panel, and we're going to play it for you. And after that, we will jump right in with our panelists today.
I have never seen a situation that I'm seeing today. I don't think when I worked on the hospital, named it after my father, and I built it, never did I expect a kind of a war zone that I'm seeing today.
I think at this particular point in time, one has to accept the fact that COVID is here to stay. It's not a, you know, a sprint, it's a marathon.
Basically, if you have fear, you cannot work. I don't think so. With fear, I cannot get into the ICU.
There are people who are thinking ki bhai ek bar ho jaye bas fir we are sorted.
So even the chickenpox can happen again. But the main problem with this virus keep mutating. So you can always have a reinfection with the different kind of strain of the virus. So
anyone who has a fever which is lasting for more than 48 hours should visit a doctor. Again, I want to stress that the mild patients do not require to be hospitalized. And we should not insist on getting hospitalized unless the patient is more than 60 years of age or suffering from comorbid conditions like diabetes, heart disease.
So mask is going to impact us positively.
Immune system has to be optimum. What is optimum means? It's not underdo and it's not overdo also.
Kindness has been found to improve your immunity. So my dear friends who are watching, write good things on WhatsApp, write good things on FB. Don't write very negative, hateful things, write positive things, and that will really help you to improve your immunity.
Okay, when we talk of corona, we should talk about positive memories, what we have done, rather than the negative memories and the fear. So we need to build these positive memories. And how we build these positive memories? By doing something new that we like, by doing something collectively, family or something else.
In my whole lifetime, I've seen at least 7 major disruptions taking place. And hence, we always know that bad times follow good times and good times follow bad times. If you don't plan for the future and start thinking about it, the future will not come to you. Take care of the present beyond imagination, because you got to live to see the next day.
Sorry, I was mute. So that was our best of the first session. And let's start with today. So anyways, a quick note, if the rains get a little too much and if anybody's broadband or anything drops off, we'll come right back to stay with us. That, I just wanted to add that someone told me to do that. Now, a rough layout of the chat, we're going to try and stick to 1 hour. So we try and kill this at 5 o'clock with all the conversations done. After an introduction to the August panel, we have a few opening remarks and then a very soft questions-based round of discussion, because we've had more than 100 people write to us with a lot of questions. So I've tried to build that in my research and in the soft flow of discussion. And yes, and then we have a few audience Q&A and of course then the closing remarks by our panel. So let me first start by introducing this panel, and I must say that I'm a little nervous because 4 out of 5 of them are principals. And it wasn't easy for me to get this together. So yes, if there are butterflies, you know why. So first off is Mrs. Sunita George. She is the principal of Bombay Scottish Mahim. She was earlier the principal of Bombay Scottish Pavai as well. And I know her as an absolute gregarious, co-building mate. But she's an open-minded educator with more than 25 years of experience in teaching and school administration. Now, all of these people here have a very long solid profile, but I'm going to cut to the chase and come to the most interesting reasons for me to choose them and have them here. So she was someone we really wanted on this panel because she has spearheaded many technology-led initiatives on a wide scale and has designed and implemented many technology solutions for improving school systems and the classroom environment. And this is all before COVID. So here is someone who's an expert. She was part of the editorial committee of the CBSE Grade 11 Media Studies textbook and was also felicitated with Social Action Award by India Development Foundation in 2015 for effectively engaging the students in community service programs. I have seen some of her initiatives as well. And she leads also Digital Safety for Youth, an initiative which encourages responsible online behavior. And this program is active in 21 schools right now. And ma'am, we look forward to hearing your perspective on the digital and the technology realm interplaying with the mainstream education in this new environment that's upon us. So thank you and welcome.
Thank you for having me, Pallavi. Thank you.
Next on is Mrs. Kalyani Patnaik, ma'am. I have heard a lot about you in all these years, and this is the first time we're actually face to face, and I'm excited about this. You don't need any introduction, much like the rest of you guys, but I will still go ahead and do that. She's been the principal of HFS since 2008 and has spearheaded the popular school for both its ICSE and IGCSE boards rather successfully. She comes with a solid background of 34 years, and she's my DU alma mater as well. She has always also worked with Bombay Scottish before and is known by a lot of my teammates. She is someone who believes in creating young leaders and has spearheaded many programs that help shape future of these young leaders. As a visionary, she supported the Moon as an IBDP and ISC initiative, and has helped create new initiatives for students like Mindscape, cabinet debates, conclaves, and the works. And also she's just procured TEDx as a platform. And I think that's fantastic. And that means that you kind of care a lot for the extracurriculars, the social development, the leadership, out of textbook things as well. Apart from, of course, the textbook things. And that's why we have you here. We look to you for your experience and your inputs that could help parents understand, because that's who our main audience today is. How to navigate these unknown terrains, you have what you have, and what do you do with what you have right now? We hear about so many kids unclear about what the next steps would be, as the chosen colleges or universities are in a conundrum themselves and they're grappling with the situation. So as you work with students and teachers from both the boards, your insights will be absolutely critical. Then we have Swati ma'am. Hello. She had a panel from 3 to 4 and I was very nervous, and there she was at 3:59. So welcome. We have almost talked to each other via our teams a lot of times, but this is the first time that we're doing this and I'm really excited about it. Very long, as of course the profile, I'm going to try and read through it.
Please don't. I'm president of Early Childhood Association. That's it.
But I have to, because it's fantastic. Hold on. So of course, president of ECA, and you've worked a lot with the preschools of India and tried to get them all under the same ambit, and which is fantastic. I think that also helps you drive a lot deeper and wider changes. And that's why your perspective is integral. Because a lot of this foundational year parents are forced or colluding to make strange decisions, as I can see as well. And this is the reason I really wanted this to happen, because as a parent, I might have certain views and they might, so anyways, Dr. Swati has been an advocate of incorporating technology smartly in little children's lives to help them learn better in a more fun way. And as I was researching on you, I was excited to see that you work with Tata Sky also with their WizKid channel. You, of course, are instrumental in putting up the world's first video-based parenting website called Born Smart. And we know you're out there, you're on social media, you advocate change, you're a change maker. So looking forward to this. You've been a proponent of using technology as a tool, and I'm really keen on getting more on that. Because I think when you speak, parents will listen. So welcome, ma'am.
Thank you.
We move on to Megha, by far the youngest of the panel and the brightest and one of the most driven leaders I've seen in the education room from very close up. the director of Just Kidding International Preschool, arguably Pawai's most popular preschool. And I just entered the 20th year of its legacy. So congratulations on that.
Yay.
She decided to join her mom's vision when she, you know, graduated from Purdue and went working in the industry. And I think she wanted to bridge the old and the new. And I think good job done. What I've admired most in the recent turn of events with her is the way she's able to quickly, you know, be agile and show how it works. And, you know, decisions within the course of a few days and actual measures at the grassroots. These are some of the things I really wanted to speak about, because a lot of small preschools are going to be looking at you, you know, with their limited coffers and their limited reach. And I think you're going to also be someone who they can look up to. And of course, parents. And we want to hear your views on how preschools will evolve from a quality parent collaboration. But I think that's something that's, as I can see, extremely important. So welcome, Megha.
Thank you. Thank you, Pallavi. At this point, I quickly want to say what I just said. Swati ma'am, it's an honor to be here with you. Swati ma'am was instrumental in setting up Just Kidding 20 years ago. So we go back a long, long way.
I was just going to say, Megha, I've seen her as a child. And today I just can't get over seeing her here. And I'm feeling so proud. And I can imagine what your mom must be feeling like, really.
Thank you. Thank you. It's an honor to be here, really. And of course, I'm an alumni of Bombay Scottish. So this is bringing back a lot of memories for me. So thank you, Pallavi.
Thank you. See, that's for education. You all know each other. You all collaborate. And I think that's what I've been trying for the last 4 years to bring on platform. I think today's a day. I'm taking too much time, but this is important. Vivek. Hello, Vivek. Quickly, he was, I've known him for many years. He was my batchmate, my colleague in Morgan Stanley. And when I got to know him again in Pawai, I was absolutely and utterly proud of him. Sorry, Vivek, to put the spotlight on you right now. He's also the founder of Speed Labs, not a school, but an innovative pedagogy and personalized education platform. You know what? That's jargon. What I'm going to, I have seen him make an impact on lives, and I have seen him work with students of all kinds, the 50 percenters, the 70 percenters, and give them confidence. He comes from a very non-English background, and I have seen him excel at work. He's an IIT. I think he was one of the top 10 to make into the IITG list. I don't know if I have the term right. He's a stud. And I think as an ideal, he's picked upon that he wants to make a lot of children who have amazing schools and stuff, and, you know, work along with schools to give that personalized touch and help children achieve their dreams as well, along with the school platform, of course. And what he's worked on is he's applied for patents, but he has also worked on AI-driven platform on which the children, let me just read this actually. He has built probably the most powerful practice platform, which is being used by many teachers across India. He's published for the international patent. He's currently working with undergrad students and PhD scholars of University of Michigan. And basically it's a platform which helps you learn and get to the proximal state of learning. His journey from a small town vernacular medium to where he is now is fantastic. And I hope that he's able to add some interesting and fantastic perspectives to how digital can help personalize and augment the school system in the times to come. Because as we were speaking with Mrs. Kalyani as well, a lot will change for not just the real near term, but for times to come. And I think all of us working in tandem, the preschool, the middle school, the senior school, mm-hmm. the outside the school, community, all of it has to work effectively in order for our children to get where they need to, which is the next step, really. So this is our panel. Welcome, everyone. Now, very, very quickly, why today and what today? Well, the COVID-19 pandemic has affected all of us. I'm going to quickly cut to the chase. The students are the happiest, I guess, we would like to think, because they were already very digital. The parents are very worried that, my God, what will they do with all the screen time? But I don't see mine complaining. I'm sure it's not the same story elsewhere. But to all the stakeholders, there are the parents who are extremely pushed. They are working. They are taking care of house chores. They are having to facilitate everything. A lot of them might be in joint families and hence quiet spaces for people to kind of interact. The classrooms are virtual classroom. That's a new normal. The teachers have had a loss of their personal space. They are being judged daily by not just children, but by parents who choose to critique everything. And they have to also manage their homes. And then there is, at all of this, the principals who are at the pivot, who have to manage everyone, the stakeholders, the parents, the children, the teachers, the peon, everyone. And they have to hold a very smart, a very strong face and deal with all of it. So we have had a lot of questions on a lot of logistical matters, of course, the fee topic. But today we want to steer away from that because this is about education, the future of education. How is that going to uphold in the next few months, years? And jumping right in, this is my question to all the principals, and you can take it one by one, is to, in the midst of all of this, what is the biggest challenge that you face? We'll start with Kalyani ma'am, I guess.
Good evening, everybody. It's such a pleasure to be here. And I know that we are all in this panel where we all have a very common a problem to face. I shouldn't say a problem, but a challenge, you know, and we have to embrace this challenge because there has been a sudden paradigm shift from the earlier kind of education to the modern education, which is going to call for a lot of transformation, a lot of changes. And what I can see is now it's no longer going to be the normalcy being restored, but there's going to be an establishment of a new normal once we get back onto the campus. We are getting ready, of course, to familiarize ourselves with all the kind of technology in education. But I can see that the children have embraced it beautifully. They are fully developed right from the tiny tots. I'm sure Swati will also agree with me that they are welcoming all these online education programs. The problem only comes with, you know, the affordability and the not being available for some of them in the far reaches of the country. But otherwise, I'm sure that this is a welcome change. And we are going to see the emergence of digi leaders now. And we have to create new leaders. We have to get technology into education. I can go on and on, but I think I will leave it to my other fellow colleagues here on this panel also to give their views. And probably when the questions come, we will be able to answer the questions in a more structured way.
Sunita ma'am? Sunita ma'am, you want to unmute?
Yeah. So I think you asked what is the biggest challenge that we have. I think you can say it's a challenge at this point of time, but I'm sure it's going to work out in favor of the bigger picture. The challenge is managing expectations, because what has happened is while we've moved online, all of us, whether it's students, whether it is teachers, whether it's parents, but something that we are forgetting here is we have to align our expectations. So I think that is a big challenge to kind of reach out to everybody and say, revisit the way you were doing. Also, you know, what you did offline, you cannot do online. I mean, the whole process has to change, and what your expectations are have to be realigned. So I think that for me, I feel is a challenge. And the way we're trying to do is we're trying to send out messages, circulars, videos on how we need to have different expectations or different learning outcomes from this whole, experience of online learning. Having said that, there's a lot of plus, a lot of things that we are actually, which was required from a long time, and which will happen because the way we are thinking about assessments and all of that is going to be we have to revisit that. And maybe in the long run, this will bring about a big required revolution in the education space and the way we look at learning and the way we look at assessments. So yes, managing people's expectations and aligning it to the new normal is, I think, a challenge which we all face every day, whether it's teachers, students, or parents.
Very well summarized, ma'am. Moving on to Swati, ma'am.
So the biggest challenge has been keeping things civil between parents and schools. It's very important to understand that none of us are to be blamed for the COVID. Then why are the two of us fighting? That has been the biggest challenge, both as a president of Podar and a president of the Early Childhood Association. has been trying to keep on teaching the schools to keep things developmentally appropriate. You can't do things for an early years child that you do for a primary years child. And you can't do something for a primary years child that you're doing for a secondary years child. And many schools were making this mistake and are making this mistake. And which is why parents have gone off completely and been put off by what the schools are doing. And the third challenge has been to make parents and schools realize that physical schools are closed, but education of the children cannot ever be closed. Because a lot of parents are thinking of 0 year and a gap year, and it's a challenge to explain to them that this is a myth. There is no such thing as a 0 year and a gap year, because your child is growing and your child will go through that age. And if you consider this a gap year, then I'm very curious to know next year which class is your child going to be in, the same class or the next class? Because if it's same class, your child is still lost a year. And if it's the next class, your child still doesn't know the learning of the previous class, which is going to even stress out the child more. So these have been the three main challenges that have been something that I've been grappling with.
Fair point, ma'am. Let's discuss more. Megha, we can't hear you.
Sorry about that. I'm going to elaborate a little bit more about what Mrs. George just said. And this was about lowering the stakes, really, you know, lowering the parents' expectations. I only speak for early years right now. And a lot of this comes to me about how is my child going to learn how to write? I'm not going to be able to send my teacher home to teach your child how to write, which is why we're taking a very holistic approach, you know. The prep two, which is senior KG in our school, was just made to do an activity where they were made to write their names with twigs and leaves, because we're doing the concept of earth and recycling and reusing, okay? And I got an email saying, hey, what is my child going to gain out of it? Your child is going to learn pencil grip out of it. Your child is going to learn how to use their fine motor, muscles in their fingers. Even so, we're going to send you activities home where they can play with atta and Play-Doh and, you know, still make use of that time. Of course, we will get to a little bit of writing and making these strokes later on. But I think at this point, it's important that we teach our children empathy, and we teach our children how to join in household chores. We teach our children, the reality of what we're facing today and really communicate with them. Learning will happen. Learning will happen anyway. It's just we are the continuum. We are going to tell you how to do and what to do. But to do, the parents have to do. They have to be our partners. So really partnering with parents at this stage is becoming a little bit of a challenge. But having said that, a large chunk of our parents have been very cooperative, and I've been very, very thankful because, you know, we've all jumped into this together. The teachers weren't trained to be here. The parents didn't know what to expect. But yes, a lot of parents have been very cooperative, and we're very thankful for that.
Thank you. Thanks, Megha. So my first question on to all the school heads, and I think, if I may say loosely, I think all of you have a new addition of a very integral and visible and vocal stakeholder, which is a parent. Suddenly, that parent is everywhere. And this is a forum that we really need to address that, because we are addressing parents. So I think that was a fantastic opening, and we're going to quickly take all the questions one by one. I realize it's 25 minutes in and there is so much to ask you guys. So I think a deep dive in now. So I will start with Kalyani, ma'am. Ma'am, you manage a full setup as per ICSE and IGCSE boards. Are the challenges unique to both of these, or are there some differences? Ma'am, please unmute yourself.
Am I audible now?
Yes,
right. Yes, challenges are pretty much the same, but the approaches to learning, the ATLs, are different. So sometimes the challenges mitigate, okay? In the sense that coming to the international board, they were already, you know, very used to uploading and getting all their, assessments being done online. So they were very used to the online phenomena.
But coming to the national board, it took us a while, because for them to overnight switch over to technology, because I used to think, you know, the smart boards in the classroom was the ultimate, but there's so much that has to be done. So I find now that these challenges have to be tackled carefully, and it cannot be done just by, you know, putting technology into education, but also learning how it works and how much of dosage is required at what time. Because one day we'll get back to campus learning. But when we get back to campus learning, it's going to be a totally different scenario where we may have to require and take the help of all kinds of new innovative ideas, and definitely what is going to set in is going to be design thinking, whether it is international curriculum or whether it is going to be national curriculum. Starting from K-12, I would say that, because, you know, we shouldn't be ignoring even our little ones, because the little ones also, their whole curriculum transaction has become so different now. I've seen, because I've been entering their classes, I've been seeing how they've been conducting these classes, and I think the teachers are doing a fantastic job.
And that was my next question. How have you seen your teachers take this on? That's too much.
They've taken it beautifully. In fact, I must say that they want to learn. You know, they have not shied away. They've not found a problem. Now, like I have Vivek here, I'm sure he would tell us exactly how to use the technology. And now I feel there's a need for people like them also to hold our hands, to tell us that this is the way forward, because we have to look at the way forward now. That is going to be the new world. It's no longer, you know, taking out your hard copy and say, come on, children, now start reading from here. Neither does it work for the little children also.
Parents, are you listening to Kalyani, ma'am?
That's how I
Thank you, ma'am. That's, it's amazing to see principals like all of you be so with it. And I think that agility, of course, as entrepreneurs, we can talk about agility at an economy level. But I think education is the first pillar of everything that a nation stands for. So awesome. And I think hats off to all the teachers. They are the frontliners as well. I'm in the era of virtual classrooms and the fear that online education might create a digital divide and it cannot replace learning at school. When we are reimagining education in the post-pandemic era, who will take the ownership of changing this existing methodology?
That's a very big question.
People, parents, everyone together, all of us.
It has to be all together. You know, of course, the school takes certain responsibility because we are the ones who design it, the curriculum, and we know exactly our job as to how much the little children should be studying, because we go according to age-related curriculum. But definitely the cooperation and support is required, and everything has to be viewed on a very positive line. That's how I feel.
Ma'am, how we talk of academics, but a lot of the school, a lot of the experience at school is about the experience, the social experience, learning how to deal with people, bullies, dealing with them, making friends, coming out of friendship, breaking friendship, all of those things. I see my own son go through so many interesting emotions, but he's just a fifth grader. How do you... What is the near-term solution to this, if there is, and how do you look at it? Is it in your mind when you're making certain plans, and how should we approach this as parents? What can we do?
See, we do look into this aspect, so it's not going to be like what it's going to be in school. Definitely, of course, we would all love to get back to the campus and the children, we'd love to have the children in the classroom. And but then if a situation of this kind crops up, it may be COVID today, it may be a war tomorrow. There could be a deluge, there could be other kinds of, natural calamities. But we've got to also live with this kind and even come closer to the emotional balance and teach them that this is the way forward and this is how we've got to work. And it only happens well if we are all together.
The resilience, adaptability and agility.
Yes.
Right? Awesome. Right. Ma'am, my last question in this round, phase would be... typical one. Many students who have gone out of 12th grade are a little confused, stuck, worried, fearful, because the colleges that they've gone into, whether abroad or in India, there is a little bit of mystery there. What's going to happen? They might be starting their online, but when you are going somewhere in US, it's not just for the online. You know where I'm getting at with this. Any tips for them? What do they do? How do their parents approach this? Their mental health as well? All of these aspects. What What do you advise?
You know, they're going to be made of the sterner stuff, like Shakespeare said. You know, because somewhere or the other, you've got to be very strong. Okay? And you must also learn how to move ahead. And all my students, most of them have already got wonderful placements in different universities. And the universities have told them that they're going to start online. And they are okay with it. And they're looking forward. And we are also utilizing these beautiful minds by telling them that any of our activities that are there, please also chip in and, you know, start doing programs for the children. And in the same way, they have also nurtured all their creative abilities, like their hobbies, and they've started thinking about their future. And I'm sure the day will come when they will be traveling, they will go to the universities. There are going to be times when there's going to be a newer kind of solutions that will get them closer to their dreams. So I don't think we stop here. It's just that unfolding. And we have to take it one by one.
Beautiful. It's not a stop. It's an unfolding. Fantastic, ma'am. That's beautiful. I'm going to move on to Miss Sunita. Kalai, ma'am, we'll come back to you with the second phase of questions.
Thank you.
Hi, Sunita. So my first question is a little tricky one. CBSE, we heard, has cut down the syllabus, right?
Right.
How do parents see that?
ICSE. So ICSE has cut down the syllabus and... but if you look at the way they have done, I mean, it's just come, but if you look at it, they have kind of ensured that the content is kind of maintained across grades. So, you know, if you look at it, it's not going to impact adversely the learning for the children. So keeping in mind that we have lesser time at hand, it is a very right kind of approach. They've involved experts and the way they have trimmed it, I can say it's trimming down. Always in a curriculum, it's always the must know and the good to know, right? So, I mean, I think they've kept that must know in place. And also, if you look at the way curriculum is designed across, I'm talking about grade 12, grade 10, and you trickle it down, it generally follows a two-year kind of, a plan. So a topic that you do in 7, you again do it in 9, a topic that you do it in 8, you again do it in 10, and things like that. So that kind of helps you to bridge the gaps. So I don't see that it's going to be, too much of a loss for the children when it comes to, this was very required. Also, in fact, I see a very good opportunity here on which I have been talking about always is the how is always more important than the what. And finally, I'm so glad that this is giving all of us as educators, teachers, parents, all of us to focus on the how and rather than the what. So personally, at our school, when we started, in the month of April, when we started designing what we're going to do, a clear instruction or clear kind of, everybody was on the same page on that as teachers and all of us coordinators and myself, that we are going to focus first and foremost is mental well-being and emotional well-being. So our focus is going to be keeping the children engaged because I think that is the need of the hour. Second is there's a lot of learning which is happening now, which would have probably not happened in a classroom setup. Personally, we all have children and we know the way they are adapting to this. They're learning things at home. There's life skill, resilience you spoke about. So, I mean, learning is not just confined to concepts. It's not about learning reflection, refraction, static electricity, all of that. Learning is much beyond that. Also, today in this era, all the more than, earlier times, I mean, we have access to information every time and everywhere. So the ability to learn is what is important. And somewhere this whole online thing and the way we are using, a lot of schools are using blended learning approach will actually help the children to become self-learners and independent learners. So I think that is very important. So I see a lot of, while there are challenges, while like somebody mentioned that there are fewer opportunities of experiencing something, you mentioned, bullying happening or something else happening, you are physically touching things, feeling things, that experience is not there. Yes, definitely that is not there. But if you look at on the other side, there are also a lot of opportunities of collaborating online, connecting with each other. Parents are getting involved. Parents are at least knowing what's happening in the kids' life to some extent. So the shared responsibility concept is, I think, something which we are going to keep it and we're going to, cherish it.
If I may oversimplify this, you mean all our Indian boards are being forced to think or approach it like the international way of,
I don't think so. I think we have kind of put them into boxes. So there's this box is created by us. None of the boards, if you look at, has ever stopped you from inventing, innovating, using technology. All boards, all Indian boards, and I, if you go to the National Curriculum Framework, if you look at what was designed way back, and the West has actually taken a lot of inputs from our own system and our own Indian education system. So I personally feel that it is we and our expectations and our madness to score high in the high-stake exams, which has actually spoiled, you know, the whole thing. So it's never...
You see Vivek smiling.
Yeah.
So I think what you said it perfect, that it allows you freedom and creativity.
Yeah, absolutely.
To take the non-discretionary aspect of content,
correct.
Or, let's say, concepts and work with that. And it takes
absolutely.
The fluff and the extra chapters at the back of every book. And I'm a CBSE product, so... I guess there were always a few chapters that teachers used to sometimes leave. I think that's just what's
correct.
Happened. And ma'am, quickly, can I ask you that were you as stakeholders and as educators involved in this process with the people who actually draft the curriculum in these 3 months? Were you working?
Some of my teachers were involved. They were, subject experts, particularly in one or two subjects. We had teachers who were actually involved, and all the schools, all the ICSE schools were asked to send inputs. So all of us, including Kalyani is here, and all schools were required to send inputs on what topics have we completed, what has not been done. And also some teachers from some schools were invited to kind of add their inputs.
Okay. Ma'am, a lot of parents are raising a big hue and cry about screen time.
So I simply love this conversation when you talk about digital safety, screen time, media balance. I think that's my favorite part.
I know.
I have to tell these parents a couple of things that suppose we have two options. And this is, I'm hearing all this hue and cry, particularly with the preschools, which the parents are going around and talking about K-2. We have two options in this situation. One, we don't do online at all. Okay. What do the children do then? They have nothing else to do. So they watch television, they play video games, they play online games. Is that not screen time?
Go chatting.
So if you look at it, screen is everywhere. You are not going to, there are ways of deciding how you want to limit the screen time. So if you're saying, in fact, it's also an opportunity to show to the child that screen is also used for edutainment, not just entertainment. So I personally see that we're making a lot about it. If you talk about K-2, for example, most of the schools, including my school, we are doing only 1 hour. We're doing only 1 hour, out of which only 20 minutes is instruction time, or where the teacher is actually doing academic work. We're following a sandwich approach. So what we do is we break it down with music and movement, activities where the children are required to use their hands, jog, run around, move your head, things like that. So there's a lot which is happening. And if you look at what is currently available to us, this is the only way, that we can stay connected and ensure that continuity is there in learning. And also the children are engaged, because we also need to look at what our parents are busy. Most of us are working parents. And how do we then keep our children busy?
Ma'am, how will assessment change in this year?
I'm actually super excited about the assessment part of it, because I really, really feel this is going to make us all rethink, revisit, reimagine. Yes, and this was required, and somewhere, trust me, I am taking this whole opportunity full 100 on 100 to drive this change, to have full conversations. I mean, the kind of conversations that we are having today, we're looking at, if you're teaching chapter X, what is the outcome that you're expecting? So how do we assess that? So we're making it so concept based, we're making it application based. So I think, and the fact that all of us as teachers are design thinking today, it's so creative. Kalyani was mentioning, when I'm going across classrooms, the kind of work they're doing. So I had this one teacher the other day, she says, go quickly run and get a serving spoon, which is the concave side and which is the convex side. In a classroom, you would typically get the you know, synthetic mirror and show them. You know, similarly, I had the other day, I was in a class and the teacher said, come on, get turmeric from your kitchen. You know, so, you know, you know, it's all in your mind.
Innovation, out of the box thinking.
Create. And the teachers have gone innovative, absolutely innovative. The way they are learning. Also, it says leveled. So when I work in a school which is 173 year old, and I have very experienced teachers, and I have some new teachers. Now, suddenly this whole challenge has leveled the ground for everybody. There's so much synergy and collaboration.
One last question before we move on to other panelists who are patiently waiting. Bombay Scottish is known for its focus on sports, and so are the other schools here. What are your messages to the sports kids who are fidgety at home?
So I think we, I mean, most of the schools like me are, like our school, are doing some amount of physical activity within the stipulated time. So we do talk about, and we also do a few fitness exercises. We also have some, you know, external sources, agencies, which are doing fitness programs with the children. So the parents have kind of aligned to that. So we, because our school is particularly, our children play, a lot of kids play football, and it's very popular. Sports is a very important part. So the parents have also taken a lot of initiative because they are also as worried. I have a student who's aspiring to be a Formula One racer. I have shooters. So they're all trying to kind of, everybody has found a way to keep themselves on their muscle movements and everything kind of agile, so that when they get back to their contact sport, they're able to play. So apart from what the school is doing, the parents have also taken a lot of initiative.
The parents have to take up some initiative.
Yes, and we've also shared some amount of links with the parents on certain programs which are doing very well. Because, you know, everybody is not equipped to do programs online, but there are certain people who have managed it well. So when we look at it, and when then we kind of, if we find something is good, we do send it across to the parents that this may interest you.
Ma'am, quick three tips, and I'm going to ask everyone, three tips for parents to deal with the new virtual classroom. And you can be a principal. So,
I think... one of the things that I would say is encourage productive struggle. You know, that's, I think, very important. At the first sign of, if you feel your child is struggling, you want to kind of help the child out. So just don't homeschool your child. The teachers and the schools are there. Just provide the necessary support. So encourage that productive struggle. Help the child create a schedule for self-paced learning. And I think most importantly, and this is for all the preschool parents in particular, do not interrupt during the class or interact with the teacher when the classes are on. Ensure that you're providing the right environment.
I think we spoke for the next two people now. So I'm going to move on to Swati ma'am. Hi. Thanks for patiently waiting. I'll unmute, please. Swati ma'am, are you going to be, we'll have to unmute you. Swati ma'am, do we have you on the call?
I said it's always a pleasure to hear Kalyani ma'am and Sarita.
Yes. Hello.
Is it done?
Yeah, we are on to you.
Yeah, I'm here. Yeah.
Okay.
Can you hear me? Able to hear me?
Can everyone?
You're not able to hear me?
See, Swati ma'am, I can hear you. I can't see your video, ma'am.
Can you hear?
I can.
Can you see it now? Can you see it now?
No, I can't see you.
You want me to go out and come back again?
Okay, let's try that. Technology guys. Yes. Hello. Hi. Yes. I think we're good now.
Can you hear me now?
Yes. Can everyone see, ma'am?
Hello.
Perfect. Yes. So I'm going to start with you now. You always spoke about the gap year. There are a lot of, can you hear me now, ma'am?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay. You already spoke about the gap year, the year lost. A lot of young parents, I can see, you know, this year we'll take a break. We will teach the child. We know what's to be done. Ek ghante, do ghante ki baat hai, we will take care of it. I want to know, and I want you to share your absolute expert views on this and address those parents.
So I respect those parents who feel that they will be able to give the foundations, who may have the time right now and may have the mental state right now to do it. But that's, I think, only 3 or 5% of parents. Mostly, if you see, parents are right now either working from home and working at home. And anxiety level in parents has gone extremely high because of financial conditions, because of medical worries, etc. So you're not in any curriculum, keeping in mind the developmental stage and the individual learning of your child. What would happen then is you may say, "Aaj nahi karega, to fir aaj thoda ye week nahi karenge, next week mein sab kuch kar lenge." So it becomes very jumbled. Right now, what children require is A, routine, B, a structure, and see a connect with the outside world. Because you and I are able to connect with the outside world with our Zoom webinars and our WhatsApps and our Facebooks and our Instagrams. Children are not having any connect with the outside world. They are cooped up with the same family members day in and day out. So it is a kind of an emotional release also for these children to A, connect with their teacher, and to see other children also on that little space. So rather than calling it screen time, I would urge parents to call it that little glass window of learning. When you will start looking at it like that, you will respect it more and not think of it as screen time. And if you want to think of a gap year, that is the most ridiculous thing that you can think of right now, because what you need to arm your child right now during this pandemic is to face the post-pandemic world. And please understand, WHO and a lot of your doctors from here on the hospital have also said that we have to now understand that COVID is here to stay in one form or the other, which means hybrid learning is here to today. There will be times when schools, so to maintain the continuity of learning, there will be online, offline, online, offline, which is what I'm saying, which is called brick screen, brick screen. So it is very, very important for us to understand that there is no such thing as a gap year. That's absolutely something that you shouldn't be telling yourself. And I would in fact advise mothers, if you are on parent WhatsApp groups that are constantly scaring you, worrying you, get off them. Get off them and come onto an ECA WhatsApp group so you get a right perspective of both educators, experts, and parents. Because sometimes these WhatsApp groups of parents can really drive you crazy. And it's not necessary right now, because as you've heard the doctors from Hiranandani also say, we have to focus on our immunity. And our immunity is built only with positive emotions. And think about your child. The only way your child is getting those positive emotions is through that singing, the songs, the stories, those activities that the school comes out with. So it's very, very important for parents to understand that don't take these decisions in a hurry. Don't think that COVID is here for this month. Next month is a push key. Please understand and please be prepared for a world in which COVID will be there in some of your child.
Perfect.
Malavi, are you able to hear me?
Ma'am, I can hear you, but there is some problem with your network for sure. Because throughout your conversation, 90% of it was very clear. Somewhere it dropped, and your video positively did not work through the conversation for me. And I'm very surprised because your audio was fairly clear. Is that the same for everyone else as well? Did we also? Yeah, so ma'am, do you want to do this? I think I will take you more questions after Megha. You come back, you go back and come in, because I do want. I know it could be the rain, and that's fine. We've told everyone. So, and I want parents to see you because it completes the message. So I'll go to Megha and you can take 5 minutes and figure this out and come back. So Megha, I'm going to come to you now.
All right.
Tell me, we talked about the continuum of education for the right. younger ones. How are you dealing it in school? How have you taken on this for all of your junior grades?
Well, for really kindergarten, so to speak, right, we cannot expect them to sit in front of a screen, Pallavi, even 20 minutes for a junior KG, senior KG child, to expect them to sit there and really teach a concept in front of a screen is just, you know, trying to say that pigs can fly. Because they're there, they're excited to see their classmates, you know, it's in grid view, and then all of that is happening. They're distracted, all right? This is a new normal for children across all grades, but so much so for kindergartners, because this is new for them. I mean, every time I can speak for my daughter, I have a five-year-old, and every time she sits for a class, she's as busy muting, unmuting. Now she's learned to put backgrounds for herself on her Zoom calls, and, you know, there's all these wonderful backgrounds coming up and it's annoying me, but there's only so much I can do to stop her. I don't want to scream at her in front of all of her classmates, you know? So, so what we've done is really taken ahead and gone forth with that blended learning approach, where we're sending pre-recorded videos, sort of introducing the concept to the child, taking it maybe two steps further, but then leaving it on the parent and the child to do a little bit of research at home about the concept, you know? So I'm not going to spoon feed you all the answers, but I'm going to send you and I'm going to introduce the topic to you. And very slowly, gradually over a few weeks, we're going to take that topic and drive the point home. But at this point, we're also taking very fun topics. We're doing things like dinosaurs and, you know, reuse and recycle and saving the planet and all of that. We're talking about digital safety online. We're talking about hygiene. So we're really not focusing so much on the ABCs and doing the numbers.
You've looked at the curriculum again.
Yes, so the curriculum has been ideated and sort of conceptualized entirely all over again, you know. I mean, teachers aren't actors, you know. It's very difficult for a teacher to sit in front of a video camera and record her lesson. When kids are in school, they collaborate, you know, they compete and give out the answer. You're not getting answers back from a camera. The teacher doesn't know how much you've really understood. So we're having Zoom calls twice a week, sometimes three times a week, and just having a fun time with the teachers, getting to interact, getting to socialize, things like that.
Megha, have teachers felt their spaces being violated a little?
Honestly, teachers have jumped right in and not complained, Pallavi, not once. I mean, when we speak about our frontline heroes, even if their spaces are being violated, I haven't had any of our teachers complain yet. They haven't said a word. They've just dived right in. And, you know, all of our teachers aren't able to make it to school. So a lot of our lesson planning and curriculum ideating is happening in the physical campus, because we're allowed to work at 10% of our capacity. So some of us are meeting from time to time. And, you know, it's a lean, mean machine when you speak of terms like Six Sigma. This is what we're doing right now.
Intuitively on ground level. Sorry, I'm just talking to Mrs. Swati. She's not able to log in and I'm just trying to understand. I think this is a network, as I jinxed at the beginning of the call. But anyways, she is trying to get back in. Megha, most parents are working from home these days, or managing homes, or doing both. How do they partner more effectively? Give us simple solutions.
You know, parents at this point in time have very tiny, demanding colleagues at home. and that's their kids. And I speak as a parent too. I have a 5-year-old and an 18-month-old, and a very boisterous one at that too. You know, and I kid you not, every day feels like a Monday going in. So I think for parents who are working from home, the biggest takeaway from this, or something that I have learned, is that having a routine is very, very important. You know, have a routine, make sure you've communicated to your child what your routine looks like. When you need to be out there working and your child shouldn't be disturbing you, you need to set your boundaries, right? Scheduling is vital. Your child needs to be going to bed at right about the same time every day and waking up at the same time every day. So my earnest request to parents is to please not treat this like a vacation. You know, it's not a holiday for any of us. Some of us are just sort of making it through the day. And I know a lot of parents are overly burdened with work, with con calls. I don't know if I can speak for a lot of people here, but I think you should have a hard stop at the end of the day. Like, your company can't be calling you at 9:30 p.m. and asking you to get on a con call. I mean, that's just disrupting family time. So I think you should make your, you know, expectations clear even to your immediate team that, hey, you know, after this point in time, I really cannot do this, but I will work till so-and-so hour. The other thing is, I think as spouses, what my husband and I have learned to do is divide and conquer, you know, your time to work, my time to play, my time to work, play, your time to work kind of deal. So you need 2 hours to do something, get it done. Let your spouse kind of work in the background there and make sure that the kids are engaged with your spouse while you take your time out to finish your work. And yeah, and you know,
routine and schedule and...
Yes, and don't sweat the small stuff, really. For parents who are working from home, you know, let the smaller things just slide. It's okay. It's okay if the painting didn't turn out right or the homework was incomplete. I mean, these are hard times for everyone. So absolutely, don't sweat it.
Thanks, Megha. That was fantastic. Don't sweat it. Thank you for the patience.
Hello.
Hi. Are you here with us? Hi.
Yeah, of course.
Thanks for the patience. And Dr. Swati is still trying and something's wrong with the networks. I've told her we're definitely here for a bit longer. So please come back in. Anyways, Vivek, thanks for the patience and jumping right to the main question. How is this an opportunity to learn more, to learn differently? Take us through that.
Thanks, Valvi. Thanks for having me. And it's an absolute honor and delight to be on this panel. And, you know, I've been hearing a lot of insights from co-panelists over almost an hour. And, you know, they have raised very pertinent issues. And all of these issues are... Hello?
Yeah, you
okay, okay, fine. All of these issues are very relevant and they cover different aspects of life, you know. You know, Megha ma'am rightly pointed out, our homes are also not designed for 2 work from school and 1 school, 1, you know, school from home and 2 work from home scenario, right? We can't have so many rooms differently, but the way I think about it, and I've been working on it for last 4 months specifically, and I see just opportunity. I mean, there are opportunities on multiple sides. So I will start from the school side, and this is just my view. And then I'll go on the parent side, and then I'll go on the student side. So from a school side, there is an opportunity to realize that every student is special. And, you know, this is where we can start treating not as a section, but as a student, right? Every student is special, and how we can use technology to figure out what are the needs of that particular student and how we can align it. And rather than being a repository of knowledge, the teachers can also become a facilitator of learning. So they can be a source of knowledge. And, you know, we are living in an age where knowledge is commodity. And you can just almost Google everything that you want to know. But teachers can actually be the facilitator of learning. The teachers can be the enabler of personalized gaps. And, you know, a speedless platform effectively works on that premise that if you give me a 60% student and you have a method by which he can move to 70%. It's not about marks. It is all about improving their confidence, their self-belief, and achieving much more than what their potential is. So that's one thing on the school side. They can, you know, work on redesigning the curriculum. In fact, they can also think whether a chapter in the offline mode requires 5 hours. Does it really need 5 hours now? So can this be done in, let's say, 2.5 hour, right? And what can be given, as you know, Sunita ma'am said rightly, is the self-paced, self-driven learning, where you can give it on the student side and work on the feedback. Other thing is that there are so many things. Now, in the physical classroom, you are constrained about a lot of things, but in an online mode, you have a lot of freedom. You can pick up things which you never thought of. You know, can you organize a seminar on, let's say, data analytics? Like almost all the future jobs will be requiring data analytics, and you can arrange, let's say, a 3 hour or 5 hour seminar where you can introduce them at different levels, like a class 6 to 10 a different level, or an 11 12 a different level, etc. Can you work on the coding side? Can you work on marketing strategy side? Like small bits and pieces, because your canvas is much bigger.
Go ahead.
Sorry, you were saying something.
I was saying that it's interesting you picked up critical thinking, analytical reasoning and all of that, because that's an aspect where you can work alongside as well. And coding you mentioned, right? So tell us more about that as well.
Yeah, sure. No, basically the thing is that the main role of students as well as school is to prepare them for future. Now, when we talk about future, what are the professions? What are the jobs? What are the career opportunities that are going to come? And if you think about it, in next 10 years, almost all jobs will require your analytical skills, your data skills, your comfort with math, not in terms of, you know, getting everything right, but having building a right perspective of analyzing things. So if can we use this as an opportunity to embed some elements of these extracurricular learnings, right, which are not part of CBSE, ICSE, or you know, Cambridge or IBDB programs, because, you know, we have been teaching all the students for last 3 years. We have taught close to 1,000 students in Powai Chandivali, and we have come across all kind of students from all boards and worked on their individual level. So what I'm trying to say is that there is a huge opportunity where you can move beyond your canvas, right? You can increase you know, different sections of the canvas and go and deliver them. And the other thing which I was saying is on the parents and student side is having this as an opportunity to think outside of your box, right? So you have, let's say, 6 subjects, physics, chemistry, math, English, whatever. But the life is much bigger than these 6 subjects. So we can have meaningful conversations at home, and you know, it is not a bad idea to share what you have been doing in your job for 4 years and give them the real view that, okay, this is what I do. I mean, there's no harm. And schools are obviously having their own, you know, set of opportunities and challenges, but students have, you know, huge opportunity. Tayar nahi hona, you know, you have to do nothing. Like, you have a lot of time. But the point is that how beautifully you can organize your timetable and do more in the same timetable, right?
Productivity, and, which everyone has spoken about.
Yes, and the technology is going to play much bigger role than a lot of us are even thinking right now. I mean, I've been working on it for last 5 years. We have been working on taking schools to hybrid model in different ways. And, you know, I always believe that the personalized education is the bridge between dreams and capabilities. So we cannot say that, you know, I am a 70% score person and I cannot achieve certain dreams, right? The only thing is that if I get what I need to get, I should not be bucketed, right? So if technology can be used to achieve some of those outcomes, I think that is where it will be a very meaningful outcome of this whole COVID situation. So obviously there are so many negatives with this COVID situation, but I still think there are so many positives also.
To all of you, I can't see the negative suddenly. I really cannot. I think it's, I see Swati ma'am back there on my window. So welcome back. But no, Vivek, honestly, this is the reason that I had you here, is that whilst everyone's a formal school, I know that someone like you with an ideal, with a certain utopian agenda, you know, to make children believe more, because you are an epitome of that. And I think I really would love for this conversation to continue beyond the screen as well. And I think this is my outreach to all the schools as well, that we have to work towards the goal, which is a more future-ready child. As Mrs. Kalyani said, that children got to have more grit. They have got to have more, you know, more of that conviction. As one of you said, that, you know, productive, let them struggle. Productive struggle, Sunita. So I think all of you have this common thread. And I think that's very, and like I said, I cannot see anything negative here. So I am thinking it's all about opportunity. And I think this is how we parents need to see it.
Yeah, and just one thing I wanted to add, Pallavi, here. Yeah, so basically what you are saying is, and what all of us are seeing is, that there are problems in terms of conducting classes, there are problems in terms of conducting assessment, as Sunita ma'am rightly pointed out. And I always believe that, you know, assessment doesn't have to be a standard template. Like if you look at it, the template that we are using today and the template which was being used in 2010, you can, you know, just compare, it's almost the same. I mean, have we really moved forward? But this whole thing can actually give you a thinking window, right? You can think what I can make differently, right? Obviously, okay, class 10th is a board exam, fine. Board will decide a certain pattern, etc. But can I experiment little bit in junior classes? Can I experiment little bit in 11th also? I mean, I'm just trying to say, because 11th, you're almost an adult, right? You are thinking about your dreams, okay, profession, etc., etc. Can there something be done very differently? So in a school curriculum, in school time frame, it is not possible, right? There are so many constraints. But here you are suddenly free of those constraints. Now, can you play
into a student mode, Vivek? With yeah.
we can just, you know, play around and have more flexibilities, and you know, think of those things which are unthinkable in a typical offline play.
Very good message. I think do the principals agree with that? Thumbs up. Awesome. I'm going to come back to you, Vivek. Dr. Swati, welcome back.
I hope you can hear me now.
I can see you. I can hear you. I'm very happy now. It's a testimony to how cool you are. You came back with a cup of coffee or chai or whatever it is. So yes, you know, a lot of preschoolers were really here for you and Megha. And so I could not have let you go. And so I'm back with you. So yes, technology. Please tell us, how have you used technology over the past few years with all your gamut of schools and the network? And how are you bridging these gaps across different kind of preschools to under ECA? So it's a two-pronged question. A, how technology? And B, how are you personally seeing this and trying to mirror it across different kinds of schools and metros and cities and stuff like that?
So basically, parents need to understand screen time can be essential and non-essential. Right now, what maximum children are using screens for is for non-essential activities like entertainment, watching cartoons, playing video games. Now enters the screen in your life, which is for an essential activity. Now, if you read the WHO guidelines, it says that 60 minutes of a video chat with a parent or a trusted caregiver is not harmful for children. And that's exactly what we've asked all preschools, both in the Podar network and in the ECA network, to do, that these should become like video chats. Please don't focus on muting, unmuting, bacha baitha hai, nahi baitha hai, as long as the child is learning. I'll give you an example. We have a welcome song because I've taught the teachers that when you are on this little screen, children want to feel that they are there and my teacher can see me. So have a welcome song in which you take every child's name. Now, I have 2-3 children in many of these schools that don't sit in front of the online session. They keep moving around and parents get very hyper about it. But the same parent, one of them, from a very remote rural preschool, sent me a video clipping of a child singing the welcome song. And she said, I'm so surprised he learnt it because he was never sitting in front of the screen, but that means my child was listening. And this is where I say both to teachers and parents, there are 3 types of learners: listeners, lookers, and movers. So when you are doing any content for children on a screen, think of the lookers. They don't want to see your ugly pot all the time. They want to see visuals. They want to see pictures. They want your face making expressions. So think of the lookers. Think of the listeners. They don't want to listen to you droning on and on. Have voice modulation. Give them games in which they have to listen to a sound and recognize the sound. Movers will move around. They will never sit in front of the screen, but that doesn't mean that they are not learning. They need physical activity to learn. And now because they are not in a classroom, they feel I have the freedom to move now. So what will you do? So you have to understand learners. Parents have to understand learners and understand that screen can be beneficial too, as long as you follow screen guidelines. You know, the surprising thing that schools and parents have done till now, they've taught children about a traffic light. You know, all these nursery rhymes on traffic lights, red, ho to stop, orange, ho to ye, green, ho to ye. How many children drive? How many children cross the street on their own? But we taught them about that technology, but we never teach them about the technology in their hand. We have to teach them technology safety. Just like we are teaching children GTBT, which is good touch, bad touch, we have to teach children that this is an instrument which is here for our health. And we can control what we do with this instrument. And that is why at Podar, we started analog-based coding for early years. So many people were shocked, oh, early years ke liye coding. But what is coding? Coding is all about if and then statements. Coding is all about putting things in a pattern. Coding is all about debugging, finding a mistake, etc. So it's all very important for those parents out there to understand that writing, your child can learn at any age. Like writing is learned by imitation. But knowing what I have written is more important. So I need to understand language before I start learning to write. So the focus right now should not be on assessment, on finding proof on paper of what my child has learned. The most important thing is your child happy? Is your child able to tell you what happened in that online interaction? Even if your child can tell you one thing, is your child looking forward to it? If your child is not looking forward to it, don't blame the school. Only sometimes a child listens to the parent criticize the online class, and this sticks to the child that if my mother doesn't like it, why should I like it? She's not in favor of it. So it's very, very important for us to understand the new normal is here to stay. So this is how we reacted when I think the cavemen first started drawing on the walls of the cave, and then they moved to a printed book. I'm sure there must have been a hue and cry. No, you can only write on walls. What is this paper? It can be destroyed also. So it is very important for us to be patient with the teachers, patient with the parents, and for parents to be patient with their child and be patient with the teacher, because a new kind of a relationship is being right now is emerging between a teacher and a child, which is through a screen. And that's why we need to be extremely careful about what we tell our child about these screen experiences.
Absolutely. And I think now you raised a very interesting point, which I have always been very cautious and mindful of. Never discuss teachers in front of children. I think these are these very common bedside manners, which I have seen so many people lack. If you're discussing fees, if you're discussing anything, I want this forum to be for my parents as well, that we should not try and take away. As teachers are, they should have their halo. We might not like them. They might have the best accent, whatever it is. This is not a conversation a child should ever get to hear. And of course, it's a different thing whether we should think like that. I'm not getting there. But here I am simply saying we need to lead by example, because you said lookers, learners, listeners, they listen. I see my son, he's picking up advertising and marketing gyan from me, you know. So
absolutely. You cannot taint your child's view of the school and the teacher. Let the child emerge with its own views. Absolutely. We are constantly impressioning on these minds our views, our thoughts. And that itself is not education. So your first step, which starts at home, is all wrong.
And I want to ask you this, that I also asked Megha, and I see that Megha is really nodding her head furiously that, you know, you cannot teach how to write and things can change and you can adapt curriculum. That's why you are teachers and that's why you have a system, you know, you have. So my other question is, do you feel teachers are under a big scanner right now for everything they do, for all the videos they do, they dance? Are we being fair to them by judging them as parents? And I want you to talk about that.
I think as a teacher, you need to understand that yours is a public profile. And so what if people are watching you? So what if people are judging you? You can't be sensitive. You are a teacher. You are at a level above everybody else. So if you read Rudolf Steiner's books, he's an educationist from Germany, and he says teacher is above God, because even God is partial and the teacher is not. So a teacher has to disconnect herself from all this and only focus on her children and the education that she is imparting. Because you can't blame parents for now, because parents have now got the opportunity. These are the same parents who wanted live relay of CCTV cameras in the classroom on their mobile phone. Now they've got the opportunity. Abhi CCTV ki bhi zarurat nahi hai, yahan pe hi hai. I can now have her, I can record her, I can catch her. I think the teacher needs to elevate herself above all this. And when she will do that, then the parents will understand and respect her more. That it's okay to make mistakes. Nobody said that the teacher is perfection incarnation. Everybody makes a mistake. I may make a mistake just now when I'm speaking. I may stammer. I may mispronounce something. That doesn't mean you hold it against me. What you should be judging me as a teacher on is my connection with the children, is my ability to make your child be interested in a certain topic. Whether I do it by speaking in Hindi or speaking in English shouldn't be your judgment about me. So I would urge all the teachers out there, please don't get scared. Please don't worry about how you are looking, how you are, you know, kya dikh raha hai and all that. Focus on your connection with the child. And very soon you will realize that parents will realize, oh my God, she's so involved. Nothing I say matters to her except the duty that she's doing every day. And slowly the parents will also stop commenting and stop judging. Because as Pallavi, you can't stop people from judging. You can't say, ha, wo meri taraf dekh rahi hai, ha, usne ye bola. We are educators. We have to stop this ha nonsense. We are educators. We do our job. I don't care what people think.
Bar high for teachers. Is what,
as long as I'm doing my job and I have the conscience that I'm doing it properly.
Fair enough, ma'am. Ma'am, I want you to give us parents three quick tips for predominantly preschool parents. We asked Megha also the same question, and give us three quick tips for parents and ones that they should always, always adhere to about classes or online classes.
Number one, please mentally tell yourself that schools won't open for another year, especially preschools. And if they won't, what is it that you want your child to miss? And what is it that you want your child to gain? Why did you have a child is my first question to every parent. You are working hard for the future of this child. So in the pandemic, when you are making your decisions because you have a financial crisis, education cannot be the first thing that you put across on. You can put across on a lot of other things, but not the education of your child. Please remember that. Number two, schools have not shut down by themselves. It's the pandemic that has forced them to shut down. So you can't blame the schools and say, I don't want to pay the fees because the school is closed. For that, you need to catch the government. Then the government should have done much more of all the countries to ensure that school is remaining on. Number three, you need to focus not on what to learn, but on how to learn, very importantly. What to learn is your content, is the Macaulay system of education. You know, I don't know if many people have read the National Education Policy draft, and there is a very important paragraph in that. It is said by one of the Chinese ambassadors in USA, and he said that for two centuries, India was ahead of China in every field until the British came. Because they damaged our education system so badly that we have now become followers rather than leaders. And it's time. This is the COVID time when the public, the parents, the teachers, the schools have to realize that other countries are continuing in some form or the other to ensure that education reaches even their littlest citizens. India cannot make the mistake of stopping education during this COVID period, because this present is going to define your child's future. If you take away the present, there is no future. So wake up. That is what I would like to say to the parents, that please understand whatever little your child is getting right now on the virtual platforms is defining your child's future. Please don't put a price tag on it.
Thank you, ma'am. I think that was fantastic. And I'm really glad that you came back, because this was absolutely precious. We've already 20 minutes overshot, but I don't want to finish this. So I'm going to have some more questions, because we have really worked hard to pretty much put all things together. So we'll try to keep them short. And maybe you can just tell me and who's going to take this question, and we can go like that. So we had a very interesting question. We are a girls' school and we conduct classes via Zoom app, which is a user-friendly interface. Maybe Sunita, ma'am, you can help us with this. The biggest drawback is unwanted entries, which need to be removed every now and then, and students' identity becomes a problem. Can we work around this?
There are guidelines given by Zoom.
Yeah. One is that. Second is, I think also, Zoom is, if you've kind of taken the free version versus the paid version. So when we go to the free version, there are a lot of, you're kind of keeping yourself out there. So we, for example, as a school, are not using Zoom. We are using Google Classrooms, and we have our own official Gmail IDs. Every student has their ID. So it's more kind of, we are able to monitor it better. Having said that, even then, there have been cases where we had, but we realized we could identify, we could track it. So I think looking at a platform which is more,
a choice of platform. We can choose a better platform.
Platform which is, Microsoft Teams is good. I think a lot of platforms which are available. Yes.
You know, this unwanted entry is a very common thing, and it's going to happen whichever platform you're going to use. Okay, first is the cyber manners that we teach the children. And then, they are mischief mongers, they do it in class also. And most of it comes within the class only. They put in, all kinds of names. So we just talk to them. And I'm sure we've got to also tell them something about the cyber laws and about all these problems. And they do understand exit also very quickly. So we have to first train our teachers also how to tackle this, because this is going to be there.
So basically, better platform, thoughtful platforms, and more holistic training on this. So we have an interesting question, which should have been a very important conversation point, and maybe all of you can pick up. What are we doing for uniquely abled children?
So I think that is where the developmental pediatricians like Dr. Samir Dalwai are having free sessions for them. The children with differing needs are facing the most problems right now, because they are missing out on their counseling sessions, on their therapy sessions. So I would urge parents out there to reach out to their counselors and to their therapists and ensure that they don't miss out on these sessions. And many doctors like Dr. Samir Dalwai are reaching out to parents and are holding these sessions in groups for the parents and the children. So it is very, very important here. The parents' responsibility becomes double. And I would urge that if this child was enrolled in a school, the school should reach out personally to such children to ensure that the child is happy, comfortable, connected. And if the child is not comfortable in a group, maybe the school can come out with maybe thrice a week, but personalized sessions for such children.
Yes, we already have a counselor on board and she started her sessions. So I think most schools are following.
Okay. Vivek, I know that this is not your realm, but have you, do you deal with different abilities kind of children, or is there something in technology that can help here?
I think they are very specific cases. And as Kalyani ma'am and Swati ma'am said, there are different, requirements which need to be solved for these cases.
Vivek, I have a question for you specifically, which is that, is it all about marks? You talked about 50 to 70. I want you to deepen your conversation on that.
No, yeah, I mean, this is always my, you know, one of the favorite topics to talk about. And you know, all of us have a different perspective on this. My thing is that it is a complete myth that marks don't matter. I think marks matter a lot from many point of views, right? Yeah, a lot. Yes, it makes a lot. And you know, there are four things which, in my opinion, it just clicks out. One is, it is not the marks in absolute sense, but marks in a relative sense where you deserve to be. Suppose I am a 60% score student, right? Can I score 70%? Okay. My answer to this is obviously and always, you can score 70%. But what is the meaning of 70% for you? There are four things, right? One is your self-respect or confidence, right? You feel better that you are delivering up to your potential. Okay. Second is your peer respect or your teacher respect in some way, whether it is very clear or not clear, conscious or unconscious. I mean, we can keep discussing about it, but at some point their respect comes through marks. And unfortunately, I mean, it is very ideal to say that everyone is equal, but the point is that at some point it reflects, right? And third is it, which is the most important thing, is that it opens up your aspirations. Sometimes students limit their aspirations because of their marks. They think that, okay, I'm not there, therefore I should not be thinking like this, right? So I'm not there. I don't believe in that. I think that if you have potential to reach 70, you should be aspiring 75. Now, what 75 means is that you can think of 10 other graduate programs or 10 other universities or 10 other professions, okay, where you want to be. And I mean, I think marks matter. And I don't want to sugarcoat thing. I have dealt with more than 2,000 parents on a one-on-one basis.
Fair enough.
And very frankly, a very small percentage of parents think that marks don't matter. Mm-hmm. That's number one. Okay. Number two is that there is another myth that we should not push our students. I also don't agree with that. I think to the extent it is possible in a, you know, humanly manner, we should definitely push our children.
Standards.
It will make them ready for future, because this, you know, over protectionism and the sense of entitlement and everything is going to get over by 18.
Fair enough.
Once you are 18 years old, then it is a free world, right? You have to compete whether you like it or you don't like it. You will have your choices. But at some point, you have to build that sense of competitiveness, your, you know, rigor, mm-hmm, your ability to reach to your potential. That matters a lot.
Okay, Vivek. Thank you so much for that view. I'm sure that a lot of parents are going to be on board with you on that. I have a question for the school heads again. How will school look visually when it opens? Quickly, your vision.
Yeah, I think definitely technology is going to be more integral part of the learning process, because we definitely are going to have some takeaways from this whole experience. So we definitely, as I see, when we are in a post-COVID situation or when we are on campus, even within with COVID in the background also, I definitely see a blended learning model, which is going to be the future, which is going to be actually practiced most seamlessly. We would probably have some amount of digital learning happening, some amount of independent learning happening, pre-assignment happening, like something like Megha mentioned. We're doing that across the grades. So, and the classroom time is definitely going to be used more for experiential learning. You know, so that is something which I see definitely happening. A lot of, like I said, mentioned earlier, the way we are looking at assessment is also, will probably go through a complete change. We'll, I think, move more towards a formative assessment, which is meant for learning. So this is something which I see on a perspective base, of course.
More digital and blended. Kalyani ma'am?
And blended, yes.
I think while Sunita has touched on the curriculum part and the academic transaction, I agree totally with her. But the new change and the new challenge that's going to happen to us is the health and hygiene.
that is going to be looked into very, very minutely, because parents will not send their children unless we are very, very, you know, reassuring that we're taking care of their health, the hygiene, you know, all the sanitizers. We've already started, you know, looking out for people who can supply different and they're in talk with that trustee.
So the physical health aspect.
It's going to have a facelift. There is no doubt about it. It's going to be different. We are going to be talking to each other with a nice namaste, maybe now more. And well, our Indian roots are going to come.
Pallavi, I think there's going to be one more side effect. And this is something that we've been trying to work on consciously from the outset, where we're trying to make children independent learners and independent thinkers from get-go, is that I think Ms. George already touched upon this, and is that we're going to have learned helplessness from children because, you know, of all this helicopter parenting that's happening at homes right now where, oh, you're not getting the answer, let me give it to you. You know, we're sending artwork to be done at home and we want parents to upload a picture of their artwork and we can clearly tell that it's the parent who's done the artwork, you know. I mean, it's anyway dreadful to have silent classrooms right now. We're waiting. We want to see children do their work, send their work, even if it's incorrect. Teachers are there to help. So I think it's my earnest request to all the parents listening that let your child struggle. Let them do their bit. Let them get their hands a little bit dirty. Just put a newspaper on the ground when they're painting.
Perfect. Swati ma'am, how will the schools look different?
In the beginning, they will look barren because very few children will attend. Then they will start having a little bit of activity with a little bit of hyperness because children are going to have separation anxiety and more than them, the parents are going to have separation anxiety. So absolutely, it's going to bring in a lot of anxiety also that we have to deal with. And I don't think we are mentally preparing the teachers for this stage where the anxiety levels of the parents are going to be at their peak when they come back to school. Then we will go from striving to thriving. And what Salman Khan Academy years back, decades back, talked about flipped classrooms is something that's going to become a reality now, both from the early years, primary to the secondary years, because it's very, very important to understand that parents have to stop thinking of schools as A, B, C, D and 1, 2, 3. Life skills is what is going to be the most important. So if you see the Gurukul system in India or the schools that Tagore started, they all talk about life skills being more important and life skills leading to academic skills. So I think if this change happens, it's going to be great for our country because we will then be able to tap the learning potential of every child.
Perfect. Ma'am, I have a question for all five of you, and a thumbs up and a thumbs down. Do you think the education system in India and the stakeholders and the caretakers are equipped to deal with this for the next 6 to 8 months? Okay. Swati ma'am, first you. Why the thumbs down?
Because they're not together right now. They're not in sync. You can only be able to solve any educational problem if the parents, the state government, the teachers and the schools are on the same platform. Right now they aren't. So it's very, very important to understand there will be knee-jerk reactions, there'll be legal battles. And in all this, the sufferer will be the child and the child's education.
Okay, ma'am, fair point. I think
Pallavi, in fact, I just gave an interview to Mint newspaper where I said that during a pandemic, the government should not keep education as a concurrent subject. It's a pandemic and education should become a priority. It's the right in your constitution. In our constitution, education is the right of every child. And because it's a concurrent subject, some states have taken away the right from the child and some states are giving the right to the child. How fair is it? How fair is it that certain children in certain states in our country right now are not getting education and certain states' children are getting education? Is that fair on the child population of our country?
I hear you, ma'am. I think given your role as somebody who looks at the macro, at the 10,000 as well as deep diving, I think you have a very fair point to make. And honestly, Godspeed to you for being able to take it forth so that more of the schools are prepared. And I'm sure that the rest three school heads thumbs up, because they spoke for themselves, right? And I think that's the beauty of this beautiful panel. We are running out of time. We already ran out of time 35 minutes back. A quick one, and I'll go one by one. A short message for all parents and a message for us to ride through the next 6 to 9 months. Kalyani ma'am, we'll start with you because you're first on my screen. Ma'am, I can't hear you.
Mute.
Yeah.
Mute.
That? Yeah. Yes. So I have only one mantra. Teaching continues. Learning happens. You cannot do without a school.
Perfect. Sunita ma'am.
Yeah, I think see the silver lining. Silver lining is we are collaborating. Parents are also taking. So I see that the future is collaboration. This pandemic has actually taught us that there's no point blaming each other, and only together can we survive. We're looking at some time blaming a community, looking at blaming a country. But I think as parents, as educators, or as people, even within the house, we can get through this time. This time has come to show us that we can, as a race, evolve together and not fight against each other. I think this is my, a message that I'll want to give it to everybody, whether it's you're managing chores at home, whether it's your child's education, whether it's, the larger picture. We'll have to be in it together.
Absolutely. That's the only way to write it out.
Right.
Megha? Unmute.
For everyone listening to this today, I just want to tell you that you need to take one day at a time. Please worry less and do more. You know how there is a connection between being positive and happy and getting more work done on a daily basis. So if you're positive and you're happy, you're going to get more done. You're going to get more out of your day. Another thing is that your child's mental health is as important. So please validate your child's feelings, show empathy, teach them to recognize their feelings at home. Yes, just stay safe, stay healthy.
Thank you, Vivek.
Yeah, hi. I think this is an extraordinary situation, and the response cannot be ordinary. The response also has to be extraordinary. And the way I would want to, think about it is, and request to all the parents, is to look absolutely differently. Think what you can do in next 6 months, which will prepare your child for next 5 years. And if you start thinking about those things, maybe you will come up with a few ideas which are more suited for your own family. And none of this is like a clear black and white answers. But I'm sure if you think along those lines, there can be some very different perspectives that can come on the dining table. So
thank you.
Have those discussions.
And finally, you, ma'am, Swati ma'am.
C is for COVID and Corona, and C is for child and children also. So I would request parents to have a balance between both. Don't get carried away about thinking or fearing only one thing. Value that you are together as a family during this pandemic. Value that you have food to eat every day. You have a roof over your head. And value that your child has certain needs, and you need to meet those needs by first satisfying those needs in yourself. I want parents to remember every day the message that every air hostess gives you, that put the oxygen mask on you first before putting it on your children. So unless and until you are not sane, you won't be able to give sanity to your children. So it's very, very important that let's think of children. Let's especially think of our littlest citizens. And let's not do the mistake that happened 100 years back during the Spanish flu, where there was absolutely no way to give education to children, and children lost almost 2 years of education. We now have technology. Let's not paint technology as Gabbar Singh. Technology is your friend, just like fire is your friend. Fire can destroy, so can technology. But fire can be harnessed for cooking and keeping you warm, so can technology. So please harness technology for the future and the present of your child.
Thank you. And here's to harnessing all the positivity I could feel here. And dearest
viewers, I want to say hi, Sunita. I haven't been able to say hello to you.
It's been an absolute pleasure, and we just overran by around 40 minutes, but with four principals and another educator and me, I think that is expected. Thank you so much, all of you, for being most
Thank you so much,
Pallavi.
Thank you.
Thank you for bringing us together.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. Bye.